Tonight, lead in the water and what Pullman plans to do about it.
And concerns from donors after Mike Leach sends out a controversial tweet.
And get ready to sing this weekend, Cougs, because Andy Grammer makes his way to town. Murrow News 8 starts now.
From Studio B on the campus of Washington State University, this is Pullman's only nightly newscast. This is Murrow News 8.
Good evening. I'm Jennifer Power.
And I'm Vanessa McMahon. Welcome to Murrow News 8.
Just days after a Pullman police sergeant was arrested for custodial sexual misconduct, another person filed a lawsuit against Pullman police. Kyle North seeks damages, claiming Pullman police officers violated his Fourth Amendment rights to protection against unlawful search and seizure. North also accused the department of negligence, battery, and assault after the officers broke his arm, tased him, and choked him until he passed out back in August of 2016. The lawsuit fully disclosed the events the night using body cam footage and testimonies. Since the incident 2 years ago, North has regained the use of his arm, but not fully. North's elbow suffered permanent damage. Recently, it was found that lead levels in some Pullman schools exceeds the EPA's action levels. Reporter Brianna Childress investigated this issue.
Thanks, Jenny. So on Monday, Pullman School District announced that two schools within the district have lead levels in different water sources that exceed the EPA's action level. There were three fixtures affected within the district, two of them at Sunnyside Elementary and one at Pullman High School. Testing was also done on all water fixtures in the district for lead, but these were the only schools with levels that were too high. Although the EPA's action level is 20 parts per billion, the school district has decided to replace all fixtures with levels that exceed 10 parts per billion as well. These sites include three classrooms at Lincoln Middle School, a fixture in the weight room at Pullman High School, and eight classrooms at Sunnyside Elementary. The impacted water fixtures are being taken out to avoid further use, and water will be shut off in these areas. In the meantime, water bottles will be provided to those impacted by the lead levels. In the studio, I'm Bree Childress. Back to the desk.
A potential new visa policy would impact students on our own campus. Mackenzie Foster reports on what international students could face next year.
Current international students studying in the U.S. can stay in the States for however long they maintain a student status. Although, this may no longer be the case due to a possible new policy change implemented by the Trump administration that will only allow international students to study in the States for a fixed amount of time.
From Yemen, Middle East. So it's a disaster over there right now. I came here just to get my education and go back, but build a better future for myself, for my country, for my family.
If implemented, this policy would affect students like Hassan, who took longer than the average 4 years to get his degree.
Approximately 7% of WC's student population is comprised of international students. This means that over 2,000 students could be affected by this potential policy change here on this campus.
The policy does not specify the maximum of time international students can stay in the U.S. and lacks details on how students are expected to reapply if they want to extend their study.
Concern for the students who have more time here, you know, freshman students just coming in, you know, maybe they might have only about 3 years until they have to renew a visa. And that can be kind of terrifying because there's a lot of paperwork involved and you never know if you can actually get declined if you have to redo a visa.
A public discussion where people and organizations can give their input about the changes is open until December 5th. Mackenzie Foster, Murrow News 8.
President Kirk Schulz wants to draw everyone's attention to the newly recognized National American Heritage Month. A commemoration recognized on both national and state levels, it seeks to show appreciation for the enormous contributions from America's first peoples. It also reaffirms the commitment to the respect of the sovereignty, cultural identity, and pledge to meaningful partnerships between tribal nations and the government. Here at the university, President Schulz plans to work closely with tribes throughout the region to build and strengthen educational opportunities. He hopes everyone will join him in celebrating Native peoples, especially those from our staff and our own students. The Washington State Department of Agriculture registered WSU's compost facility as organic, responding to the need for organic compost at the Eggert Family Organic Farm and other Palouse area farms. This will help organic farms grow food more economically and sustainably. Compost helps build long-term soil fertility and stabilizes it to resist erosion, reducing the need for those expensive or bulky fertilizers.
On a lighter note, it's officially Dad's Weekend at WSU, and the university has plenty of fun things to do with your dad or family this weekend. Tonight, the Brelsford Visitor Center kicks off with a wine tasting, as well as Brewfest at the Marriott and a Cougar Sports Trivia Night at the Alumni Center. On Saturday, you can check out Beef and Brewfest, which starts at 4:45 at Ensminger Pavilion. Theater and Nuthouse paired together to put on an improv comedy show for Dad's Weekend. Brianna Childress took a look into what goes into a show like this.
If you didn't get your tickets for the sold-out Andy Grammer show for Dad's Weekend, there's another show you can attend on campus. Nuthouse Improv Comedy in the Cub.
They have no idea what to expect, and then they come in and they're like, oh my God, they're funny. So, and it's fun for them to see like people their age doing improv comedy and trying to make them laugh. And I feel it's just like a really good stress relief for everything that's going on in your everyday lives.
Now, even since the performing arts budget cuts last year, Stage has continued to donate the proceeds from some of their events to charity.
The Cub gives us one free space a semester, which is really amazing. And that free space we use every, like all the proceeds we get go to charity. I remember last year we did a show and we donated all the money to the Alternatives to Violence and the Palouse. So at least once a semester we do a charity show and we donate all of our proceeds.
Mystery writer says that although they receive no financial support, they've continued to maintain a strong presence on campus.
Come see what we're doing. Like, we're doing like shows even though we don't have support from the university. We're doing everything we can to still bring theater on campus.
Nuthouse will host their improv comedy night tonight at 9 and tomorrow at 4 and 10 p.m. in the Cub Junior Ballroom. Tickets are available online and at the door. Brianna Childress, Murrow News 8.
Well, tonight we will finally get to hear the song that took WSU by storm, performed live. Andy Grammer makes his Pullman debut tonight at Beasley Coliseum as a stop on his The Good Parts tour. Grammer's song, Back Home, turned into the song of Pullman back in 2015 as part of the homecoming game. After waiting for years, students finally get to see Grammer play the song live in Pullman. Back Home represents what Pullman means to WSU students and alumni, and how that Cougar spirit always brings us back home.
Is your dad or your family members coming up for Dad's Weekend?
Oh yeah, he's so excited. My dad looks forward to this all year long.
Very good. Yeah, so do mine. My parents love this weekend.
So fun.
Well, I can't wait to sing that song, We Always Find a Way Back Home. La da 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 da.
I love it. I can't wait. All right, we'll be right back and we're going to take a look at the Google walkouts that took place yesterday. Stay with us.
Leaving hot coals improperly extinguished can cause a wildfire.
Hey guys, it's Smokey!
It looks as if Smokey is going to use the drown, stir, drown, and feel technique. After the first drown, a good stir. Next, another drink. And finally, a close feel.
Is it cool?
Okay. Yeah.
Hey, Smokey, catch!
Oh, my bad, Smokey.
Only you can prevent wildfires.
Green hat. Red hat. Oops. Red shirt. Blue shirt. Yellow shirt. Oops. Red pants, green pants, oops!
Here's to the things that can keep us safe. Those we use all the time with hardly a thought. Those that are silently standing by to save our lives. And now, those that we carry with us everywhere we go. Many mobile devices will now bring you wireless emergency alerts, real-time information directly from local sources you know and trust. With the unique sound and vibration, you'll be in the know, wherever you are.
Halloween provided an extra scare this year after different parents found pins and rat poison in their kids' candy. One of the parents turned in a candy package to the OMAC Police Department here in Washington. They found a pin with a plastic tip the same yellow color as the Nerds boxed candy. Another set of parents reported a similar pin found in a Snickers bar. A child in Boise found a bag of rat poison in their Halloween candy, but they can't remember what house they received it from. The police department states they take this situation very seriously and will continue to investigate. Two local environmental groups have filed a lawsuit against the United States Department of Agriculture Forest Service, alleging it violated federal law in the planned sale of a large crop of growth timber located in the Nez Perce National Forest. Friends of Rapid River and Friends of Clearwater claim the clear cutting will not help prevent wildfires or diseased insects, but instead will negatively impact elk, marten, fisher, and woodpecker populations.
Employees at more than 40 Google offices around the world have walked out in protest this week. Two different offices took it to the streets in Seattle, upset over the handling of sexual misconduct allegations towards certain Google executives. The organizers of the protest have produced a list of demands, including an end to forced arbitration in harassment and discrimination cases, equal pay, and a clear process for reporting sexual misconduct both safely and anonymously. Google CEO Sundar Pichai says he supports these walkouts and will listen to ideas and turn them into action. Seattle police continue to look into what caused a driver to crash into the lobby of UW Medicine's Northwest Hospital and Medical Center. The car apparently went across the courtyard in front of the entrance, hit a pole, and then bounced into the lobby, into the waiting room at the ER. The car caused extensive damage and stopped at the reception desk. Police couldn't find any obvious signs of impairment, but they will continue to investigate.
The drive to have more people voting across Washington may have worked after a record number of ballots have come in across the state. With only a few days left to cast votes, nearly a third of all the registered voters in King County have already sent in their ballots. Over a third in Spokane County have also sent in their ballots. On Thursday, across the Evergreen State, a total of 31% of the total 4.3 million voters have made their voices heard this election. One of our very own WSU alumni may make her debut as Miss Washington. Miss Whitman County Jordana Dahman will fight for the title this Sunday. Dahman grew up in Uniontown and went to Colton High School. We wish her the best of luck. When we return, Jasmine Durachi brings you the latest updates on the current winds and weather.
And we'll give you an update on yesterday's power outages. Stay tuned.
Fix them, sparks from dragging tow chains could cause a wildfire, and that could be scary.
Ah, Smokey!
Only you can prevent wildfires.
For all the papas out there, let's stop what we're doing and take a moment. A moment to be with our kids. They can be loud moments, goofy moments, sporty moments, dorky moments, kooky moments. Moments where we talk or walk or just hang out. It doesn't really matter. They all count, because every time dads take a moment to be with their kids, well, it's pretty momentous. So let's all take a moment to make a moment today.
Being prepared is a part of who you are, but it's especially important in the case of a disaster. Be informed about possible emergencies in your area. Make a plan that covers where you go in an emergency. Build a kit with the things you need to survive. There's no one more capable of planning for your situation than you. Start your plan today. Go to ready.gov/myplan.
What to expect when you're expecting?
Like here?
A teenager.
Today, I'm going to show you how to team-proof your home. First step, hide the car keys. Preferably somewhere they would never look. Challenges will come up. Be ready for them. Hi, honey.
Ready for the...
Mom, you don't use mannequins in the mannequin challenge.
You don't have to know it all to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care will love you just the same.
Well, it is getting pretty stormy out there. We're actually in a wind advisory right now. And I can tell you, last night I was here in the studio, and during the show, the power actually completely went out.
Yeah, that is just crazy to me. I was actually downtown Pullman at Black Cypress having dinner with my parents, and they were getting phone call after phone call because other restaurants were losing power. Yikes. And they were just like, do you guys have any reservations? I even saw on Snapchat that South Fork's power was flashing on and off.
Oh. Well, I hope that the weather can hang on a little bit longer for the Dad's Weekend game tomorrow, but let's see what Jasmine has in the Weather Center for our forecast for the next few days. Jasmine?
That's right, you guys. It is so windy out there. In fact, we're actually going to be on a wind advisory today until about 5 p.m. I personally walked outside a little bit earlier today, and I truly lost my balance for a second because these gusts are hitting it up to like 50 miles an hour, so it's pretty crazy. For today's weather, if you look outside your window right now, it's about 50 degrees. You're going to see some showers. We had a high today of 59 degrees, and our average temperature was 49. And like I said, those winds, anywhere from 25 to 50 miles an hour today. It's absolutely crazy, and that's the reason for all these power outages that we've been having. And going stateside, we will see that today's high was 59 and our low was 40. Spokane had a high of 60 and a low of 40. Wenatchee, a high of 62 and a low of 43. And Yakima with a high of 66 and a low of 41. Showers all throughout, just showers and wind. That's the main thing that we're gonna be seeing over on the east side of the state. Moving on over to the west side, not as much wind, but it is still a lot of rain. I even saw some flood warnings for Seattle, just some flash floods. We're going to have some highs in the 60s over on the west side, lows about 40s. Vancouver, low of 50, Seattle, low of 51, Olympia, low of 48. And all these weather conditions are just super crazy right now. Tomorrow for the game, you are going to want to make sure to bring a poncho and a coat because it is going to cool down quite a bit. We're going to wake up to a temperature of about 48 degrees in the afternoon, only heating up slightly to 50, clouds throughout, and then the game kickoff time is at 7:45. So when you are heading to the game, do not forget your rain boots, do not forget your poncho, because it is going to be a cold one, but I'm willing to bet that there's still going to be a lot of Cougs there anyways, because weather doesn't stop us, right? And looking on to our week forecast, Sunday, windy again, a high of 53 and a low of 36. Monday, a high of 49 and a low of 35. Tuesday, a high of 48 and a low of 31. Wednesday, a high of 47, low of 41. And Thursday, a high of 47 and low of 33. We're not going to be seeing as much rain next weekend, although the coldness and that cloudiness is still going to continue all throughout. The winds will settle down by tomorrow, which is the good news. So when you walk outside, you won't be losing your balance like I was today. Back to you guys at the desk.
When we come back, we'll talk about couches on fire.
Hope we don't see any of those this weekend. Also, we'll give you an update on the new student athlete of the month.
Okay, so we drowned the fire.
Yep.
Stirred it.
Mm-hmm.
Drowned it again.
Mm-hmm.
And now just feel if it's cold.
Yeah.
Cool.
Smokey just gave me a bear hug.
I know. I already posted it.
Did you hear about the pony with a sore throat? He was a little horse.
Can I tell you a cat joke? Just kidding.
Why couldn't the
why was the basketball court all wet?
Why?
Because the players kept dribbling all over it.
Where'd the cats go on vacation?
New York.
It's a beautiful day out here, sunny today with light breezes, giving way to clouds in the afternoon. We could see some light precipitation to moderate precipitation later on, followed by powerful storm-like conditions. 70 miles per hour winds are expected. According to asking everyone, stay indoors.
The city of Pullman now allows small recreational fires within city limits. Pullman City Council voted to do away with requirements that required fire pits to pass inspection and homeowners to have a permit. The new rules fall in line with Washington state regulations and limit recreational fires in Pullman to burning firewood, Duraflame, Presto logs, or charcoal. People must place their fires at least 25 feet away from a structure and 10 feet away from property lines. The City of Pullman Fire Department reminds the public about possible criminal consequences for illegal burning. The warning comes ahead of a potential for more celebration couch fires, which seems to have become a tradition following WSU football home victories. The fire started last year and continued last month when six blazes were set on College Hill after the Cougars defeated Oregon. The fire department reminds citizens that first-degree felony arson could result in up to life in prison. Felony reckless burning could lead to a five-year prison sentence, and misdemeanor reckless burning could land someone in jail for up to a year. I mean, I am so excited for the football game this weekend.
Me too. After the last home game storming the field, I have a feeling we're going to get another win this weekend.
Hopefully. I really hope so. And hopefully we now have Patrick Gerardis in the studio to give us a breakdown of what to expect for the game tomorrow.
The number 8 ranked Cougs return home to Pullman to face the California Golden Bears on Saturday. The 7-1 Cougs look to continue the high of a thrilling 41-38 victory on the road over Stanford, while the 5-3 Bears come off a nail-biting win at home over the Washington Huskies. A win would send the Bears to their first bowl game under head coach Justin Wilcox. When these two teams went head-to-head last year, Cal slaughtered WSU in Berkeley to the tune of 37-3 while racking up 5 interceptions from quarterback Luke Falk. With current quarterback Gardner Minshew in command, the Cougs hope to avenge that blowout loss. This game also has significant implications for the Pac-12 North standings. The high-flying Cougs could seize the division if they win out, putting them in control of their own destiny. The Cougs enter the game as 10.5-point favorites. Complaints came to light after an old tweet from WSU football head coach Mike Leach resurfaced. The tweet said, quote, "Listen to this. Text your thoughts. There's a lot of disagreement on government, so I think an open discussion is always in order. Tweet your thoughts. Maybe we can all learn something," end quote. The tweet also included a video of former President Barack Obama that someone edited to change what he said. The tweet angered donors, and Vice President of Marketing Phil Wylor commented that some donations have been rescinded, while others were nothing more than threats. We want to give well-deserved props to Chandler Teagan and Claire Martin. Their athletics and, more importantly, their academics allowed Academic Services to name the two Student Athletes of the Month. Teagan earned a 3.91 and Martin holds a 3.22 GPA. Teagan finished in the top 10 in the last two Pac-12 championships, and Martin holds the school record for block assists. Congratulations to them both. Thanks to a number of big-time goals and clutch saves, juniors Morgan Weaver and Rachel Thompson earned their second Pac-12 Weekly Player of the Week awards. Weaver was named the Pac-12 Offensive Player of the Week, while Thompson took home the distinction of Pac-12 Goalkeeper of the Week after leading the Cougars to a win over 4-2 Cal and a tie with number 1 Stanford. For WSU, the two weekly awards were the team's 7th and 8th honors of the season. With seemingly all of the fall sports here at Washington State University doing well, Noah Schmick went to the South Fairway Playfields to find out how one Washington State club team continues to dominate alongside their varsity program counterparts.
Hiding behind a hill, the South Fairway Playfield hosts Washington State men's rugby practices. But after 3 blowout wins, WSU men's rugby club president Brandon Zirkel says their upcoming opponents know WSU won't hide from any competition.
We're top 30 in the nation for D1AA. We've ran over the top of Eastern and Gonzaga, which they're in our pool, and so that puts us at the top of our pool right now.
Unlike varsity programs, the men's rugby club must pay for their own equipment and travel expenses. But Zirkel expresses high hopes for a possible status change to the team in the future.
Honestly, in the next 5 to 10 years, I'd love to see WSU rugby become a varsity team. And so we're hoping this year with fundraisers and things like that, we can take another step towards that.
WSU men's rugby vice president Gareth Henderson says that American football and rugby have some of the same sports terms, including this one, tackling.
Henderson adds that the rugby team saw a greater turnout of incoming players than in previous years, greatly helping the undefeated team.
Getting more numbers out, getting a lot of guys out this year is helping us out because we got depth to our chart, and with all of that, it brings some competition, so nobody's skipping practice and expecting to play on Saturdays. They got to be there putting the work.
Washington State men's rugby travels down to Boise, Idaho to take on the Boise State Broncos on November 10th to keep the undefeated streak alive. Noah Schmick, Murrow News 8.
After the break, we'll tell you about mini Michelle Obama and why she's going viral.
We'll be right back.
Did you know parking over tall, dry grass can spark a wildfire?
Only you can prevent wildfires.
Can I tell you a cat joke? Just kidding.
Why did the girl ask the mushroom to dance? Because he was a fun guy.
What do you call a pig that knows karate?
Pork chop.
So how does a tissue dance? Put a little boogie on it.
See on page 4 that the projections need to be
earthquake
next Thursday.
Seriously, Thursday? Can't do that.
This is really inconvenient.
I have yoga that day.
I have no time for this.
So
I can't do Thursday, but I can do Friday.
Disasters? Don't plan ahead. You can. Talk to your loved ones about how you're going to be ready in an emergency. Don't wait. Communicate.
What to expect when you're expecting a teenager.
Today we're talking about how to wake up your teen, and this works literally every time.
Good kisses. Good kisses.
You heard how loud
I heard. I heard. It wasn't you.
Yeah.
It was the...
Is that bacon?
You don't have to know it all to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care will love you just the same.
The University Recreation Center will host activities and events all month long to promote Movember, a charity to raise awareness for men's health issues. WSU started promoting Movember back in 2014. It started as a focus on prostate cancer, but has grown into other men's health issues, including mental health. The events include Dad's Bench Best, Primitive Fire Building, and a masculinity workshop.
Here's a cute story. A 3-year-old inspired by Michelle Obama's recently unveiled portrait at the National Portrait Gallery decided to dress up as Michelle Obama for Halloween. Michelle Obama saw this photo of her looking at the portrait and invited her to the Washington office. The 3-year-old went trick-or-treating in Washington, D.C. And her little sister dressed up as a police escort, of course, because the First Lady would need one. The costume got her lots of candy, and Michelle Obama even tweeted about it and said, quote, "You nailed the look. I love it."
Can you imagine being that young and having Michelle Obama tweet about you and like talk about your costume?
I'm pretty jealous of her, honestly. Oh, yeah. It's pretty cool.
Definitely made me smile when I saw that. That was amazing.
Pretty creative for a Halloween costume for a 3-year-old, if I say so myself.
Yes, and I mean, shout out to the parents. I think that, you know, they helped her nail the look.
Definitely creative.
Yes, absolutely.